Hi everyone, this is Dr. Marwa Kaisey. I'm a board-certified neurologist and neuroimmunologist, and it's been a minute. I've had a lot going on with work, but a week ago, an article was published in Science, and it's just been all over the headlines, both in Science World headlines and in just regular headlines, and it's made its way into podcasts of people that don't even talk about MS recently. So there's been a big fuss over this. And so I thought I'd hop on here today at your request and kind of explain what the fuss is about. So I was a little confused for a while because I did not understand where the news was, right? Like, this article is a very well-respected team. It's published in one of the top, if not the top, science journals. It's literally called Science. It doesn't get much better than that. But really what they published and what they told us is something that we already knew. They just proved it in a nice way. And what we know is this, that everybody who has MS has been exposed to the EBV or Epstein-Barr virus, 100%. And this is a virus that, if you're symptomatic with it, causes infectious mononucleosis, or the kissing disease as it used to be known. And you don't always have to be symptomatic with it. You can get the virus and never show any symptoms, especially if you're young. If you're exposed as a toddler, for example, you may never show symptoms, or it may just be like a regular cold, all those colds that little kids get that we never really know exactly which virus it causes. But then if you're a teenager or an adult, when you get it, it can cause, the swollen lymph nodes, the months of fatigue. It can be a lot more dramatic and debilitating. So common virus, I said 100% of people with MS have been exposed to it at some point in their lives, but about 95% of the general population has also been exposed to it. So it's not like this virus is the one thing that causes MS. If it was, 95% of the population would have MS, right? Because almost all of us have been exposed to this virus at one point or another. But what we've known for a long time is that everybody with MS has been exposed to it at some point. And what we've also known that this article didn't really touch on is that the younger you are when you're exposed to this virus, the less chance you have of getting MS. So people who are exposed as teenagers or adults to this virus are more likely to develop MS than people who are exposed to it when they're younger. So what did this article do? Well, they basically looked at military records from 10 million people who had given blood samples. And they went in and looked for specifically 800 people who had developed MS and about twice as many, 1,600, who had not developed MS. They used those as a control. And they looked at who had Epstein-Barr virus exposure. You can kind of tell this from a blood sample, and who didn't. And they found that 35 people who ended up having MS later didn't have exposure initially, got it later on. And so, basically, again, showing that you really need to have exposure to this virus to have MS. So what do we do with this information? I was on a call with other MS neurologists a few days ago, and we were kind of half joking that we're expecting mono clinics to pop up all over the place, like Lyme clinics have popped up, these sometimes pseudoscience-y places that are very, very, very expensive to be seen in and aren't always really based on truly what's best for the patients. But, we were thinking this may become a moneymaker because of people looking to take advantage of the media buzz around this study. But really, what do we do with this information? So I already said that we're exposed, a lot of us, as young children, maybe even as teenagers, and before it happens, the exposure happens before somebody develops MS. So one of the ways we can use this information is to try to develop an EBV or Epstein-Barr virus vaccine. And can we maybe vaccinate everyone as part of their childhood series of vaccines and maybe prevent MS from ever hurting anyone again? Or maybe we vaccinate people who are at risk, like kids with a very strong family history of autoimmune disease or MS. So the first way that we can use this information is through prevention, through preventing MS from happening, because as we just said, you need to be exposed to this virus to ever have MS happen. So if you're not exposed, you may not ever get MS. So again, prevention is number one, but can we use it to treat people who already have MS? That is, again, research has been going on for a while. It's nothing new. One of the studies that I'm aware of is, I think it's called Atara Biotherapeutics, through a study ATA-188 that they're doing. And what they're basically doing is, and in, you know, we talked about B cells and T cells in my review on immunology, dental immunology. So you can find that quick review there if this doesn't all quite make sense. But the way that the Epstein-Barr virus works is it attacks B cells, goes into the nervous system, the brain, and triggers demyelination. That's why it's a requisite for MS. So what this company has done is to develop T cells that can go in and take out those Epstein-Barr virus infected B cells and hopefully stop them from creating more damage in somebody who already has MS. And they have very, very early data. It's like a tiny, tiny study. But what they're claiming is that they have actually slowed progression or even turned back disability in the people that they have in their study. And they're specifically looking to recruit, I believe, people who are not having inflammatory attacks. And I love hearing this because there are so few studies that are targeted for that, or so few treatments that are targeted for purely progressive MS without targeting the inflammation, which we're actually pretty good at doing with our existing disease modifying therapies. So that's an exciting route to explore. So in summary, this is a very well-respected study that just proves something we already know and have been researching and thinking about for many, many years. And that is that there is a virus that seems to be a prerequisite for developing MS. Now, this virus is not the only thing that causes MS. It has to find the right host. It has to find the right person because almost everybody out there has been exposed to this virus. Almost all adults, I should say, have been exposed, 95% of us. So if you're watching this video, I can almost guarantee that you've been exposed to this virus at some point. But if it finds the right host, somebody with the right genetic material, the right latitude where they grew up, the right vitamin D level, who knows what other viruses this may interact with, if it finds the right host, then you have enough to trigger what becomes MS.